Don't forget to check out Nerd to Know Bases here on Phoenix 92.5 FM with myself, Darrow O'Connor, and Bryn O'Rourke for everything nerd culture, video games, comics, and so much more. That's Nerd to Know Bases, 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. every Saturday here on 92.5 Phoenix FM.
Broadcasting from the Blanchistan Center, this is Phoenix FM.
The internet is a communications tool used the world over where people can come together to bitch about movies and share pornography with one another.
According to the Nerd Index, you should be upside down in a junior high toilet around the clock.
This is Sparta!
All your bases are belong to us.
Leave Benny alone!
Leroy Dragon!
Objection! The balls are inert.
And now it begins.
Alright guys, we are live here on Phoenix 92.5 FM. We're gonna do it this way.
Okay, so you can hear me, but I'm not on the board, so that's a bit weird.
We're doing it live, guys. We're doing it live. We're doing it old school.
Yeah.
Bear with us, guys. Bear with us. How are you, sir? How's the Christmas break?
Oh, it was a Christmas break. You know, it was just nice. Sat down, watched a bunch of really awful films, which is how Christmas should be spent.
What did you watch?
Flash Gordon. Oh,
like the original Flash Gordon from back in the day?
Yeah, the Christmas classic that is Flash Gordon, the 1980s one. Not the.
You know, I never would have considered it a Christmas classic.
Yeah, I wouldn't have either. But I got into an argument with someone about. I did a play a couple of years ago where they wanted to end on a Christmas thing. And I don't know where I just started doing the Flash Gordon theme. And so it's not a Christmas film. I went, no, I'm going to make it a Christmas film though by watching it. So it's just been this, it's become this thing for me of watching it. Just purely so that I can have at some point, I think going, it's a tradition for me. So therefore it's Christmas. You know, it's kind of like another layer to the whole Die Hard argument. You know,
well, before Christmas there, Die Hard was officially put forward as not a Christmas movie.
Yeah, it depends on who says it is and who says it isn't, though. Like,
Bruce Willis said it wasn't.
Yeah, Bruce Willis says a lot of things, you know. Bruce Willis has also beaten his wife, so I wouldn't take his opinion on everything.
Fair.
You know, like, it's, look, you know, if you consider Christmas, like, I think the requirements for what is and what isn't a Christmas film is, do you watch a Christmas, then it's a Christmas film, you know, like, I don't think that, like, there's any other requirements for it, because there's nothing really about E.T. that's Christmassy, but it's on every Christmas. There's nothing really Christmassy about the Indiana Jones films, but they're on every Christmas, you know.
I'm pretty sure the Indiana Jones movies are more Christmassy though than not. I'm pretty sure the Indiana Jones movies are more Christmassy than not.
Well, they're just family films, you know? Like, I mean, Die Hard
except
is
the second one.
Like, I mean, Die Hard's more like it's Christmassy in the same way that that Home Alone is Christmassy, and that they're both set at Christmas, and that's about it. You know, like,
Fair enough. I'll give you that. What did I watch over Christmas? Well, I was sick again over Christmas, of course.
Oh, really? You sick? That never happens.
Some inside jokes there, guys. Jokes. But I get sick every Christmas, but I didn't get pneumonia this year.
You get sick every month? This flu.
Not every month.
Every other month.
Every other month. Every other Tuesday. Yeah. I pretty much just watched Netflix.
Yeah.
So I watched a lot of what they had to offer. It saw Bird Box before it became a very, very tiresome meme.
Yeah.
I watched Castlevania, the anime, which is surprisingly good.
I watched the first episode of that, and that was really good.
I was shocked how good it was. I wasn't expecting it to be as good as it actually is.
Yeah. It didn't surprise me, but I wasn't. It didn't surprise me that it was good, but at the same time, it was kind of like, a pleasant joy for it to be watchable, you know? Like, I kind of went in with no expectations, like, in either way. I didn't expect it to be good, but I didn't expect it to be bad either. And I was just I was pleasantly surprised with how well it presented itself. You know, but I think, I got the impression anyway that, like, they took a lot of cues from more like a more hallowed anime like Helsing, and kind of used that as an influence for the anime styling of it. But man, it's still like, I mean, I want to get back into it because I really enjoyed that first episode. I thought it was really enjoyable, but
it gets a lot better. It picks up around the fourth episode, when you fill out the cast, because you're not really sure where it's going to go or what they're going to do, and then it picks up and you're like, oh, this is what we're doing. Okay.
So I did, over Christmas, I remember as well, I did actually watch the Christmas special for the new Sabrina show.
I meant to, and then everyone told me it was terrible. I'm like, oh no.
I wouldn't say it was terrible. It's just like, so like, I mean, a lot of the misgiving, like I like the new Sabrina show, but I have misgivings with it, and all my misgivings are around show in that episode. And it made it hard to like it when you're kind of, when you kind of see everything you don't like about the show in one episode. You know, and the fallback for me watching it was, now I'm kind of going, well, you know, it's going to do the second part of its season, or how, if maybe it's calling it season's parts for some weird reason. But like, when it does that second part, if that second part doesn't really give me any more faith that the show is actually going to improve, I think I'll probably drop it, because there isn't, at the moment there are blemishes, but you know, the most recent episode brought up a lot of worrying signs to me. Like, it basically, like, you've seen the first 12 episodes of Sabrina, right? So, you know, the way there's like, Sabrina has this pretty much 12 episode long arc that she goes on, where she kind of realizes that, like, she doesn't really know everything, and she kind of needs to hold other people's counsel a bit and actually take what they say into account.
Yeah.
So she goes back on all of that in that episode, and that's a big, like, you know, there's like, in the original sitcom version, this happened all the time, but like, sitcoms, you're kind of given that leeway of going, well, you know, you're not really in a sitcom for character growth. When you're doing a serious show, you kind of are. And for me, that was a big issue. And it's something that, if they're not careful with it, it is going to drive me away from watching it.
I don't think the show still knows what it is.
Yeah, well, you know, also getting sued by the Satanic Church isn't going to help either.
Yeah, but they're going to sue because they use the...
Yeah, they sued them for defamation.
They sued them for two things. They sued them for defamation, but they also sued them for using the Baphomet statue without consent.
Yep.
So I don't know. It's like, when I heard that, I'm like, this is really petty, but you know, it's like...
The reality is that that symbol is copyrighted, so they're fully within the rights to... They were fully in the rights to make a claim. I think it was also the fact that, like, they strengthened it by putting through the defamation suit as well, because they're basically saying, you're claiming the Satanic Church is involved in cannibalism, which we're not. So, like,
yeah, and there's like a bunch of sacrifice and all that kind of stuff, and you're just like, a bit, I don't know.
It was fairly open and shut.
when you're trying to be real, well, okay, right, with the show in general, there's a lot of mystique around it, right, as far as its time. So when is it based? Because you don't really know it's based in modern day until You still don't really know. Like, yeah, they have computers. That's the only one that really based it in modern day. The rest of it is kind of like in this Emerald Riverdale time setting, you know, where it could be the 50s, it could be the 70s. But
yeah,
you know,
it's basically any time between the 50s and present day is when it could be. But yeah, I think, I enjoyed the show mostly. I think, I think every character is really, really well drawn and really well presented, apart from Sabrina, which is a problem because she's the principal character. But, you know, when it comes to the rest of the show, I think most of it's really well put together. It's also really cool to see Miranda Otto again, who I hadn't seen since the Lord of the Rings films.
Lord of the Rings. It took me a long time to realize who that was.
yeah. And
I'm like, well, okay, this is great that you're alive and working.
Yeah. But then there was also the, the guy who plays the satanic pope. I can't think of his name. He was in a really bad English sitcom called Coupling. And it was just weird seeing him show up in this as well. We're like, oh, okay. And there's also like a weird link now, where a closed loop link, where like he worked with one of the actors who was in Pirates of the Caribbean, who worked with Orlando Bloom, who worked with Miranda Otto. So it's a bit strange to see that kind of close in. But outside of that, I can't think of anything else on Netflix I was really watching. Just mainly digging into games like Red Dead Redemption, which is, it's very, very good. Like, it's very, very good.
I haven't played it yet, but I've heard nothing good things.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of what you expect from Rockstar at this point when they're doing their story-driven open-world experiences. Pretty much every nice thing that has been said at this point. I remember, even though I heard loads of stuff about like the detailing being really, really well done, I didn't really kind of believe it until really in the game you go off and you hunt, you have to hunt deer. But within about a minute of having a deer, like pull it up on the back of my horse, it was covered in snow. And it was just like, whoa, that's really impressive, considering that like it's just from the snowfall from the game world. But it was just pretty, like, really nice to see like a believable amount of snowfall come onto it, rather than just being either not covered in snow or just entirely covered in snow. The detailing is kind of what most people have been singing their praises about. I haven't played enough to see the full scope of mechanics being used, but it's still very much Rockstar doing what Rockstar does with open world games.
Very cool.
Yeah, and it's what you kind of expect to see at this point from them. You know,
there's a lot of games from different sales now that I've been working through it myself. So
yeah,
I finally got around to playing the new Gundam game. It's fun because it's Gundam. It's not fun for any other reason. Like, it's a very clunky game.
So if it was literally called anything else, you'd be like, this is one of the worst games I've ever played.
No, but it's just no, no. But it's just, yeah, like you take what you can get. You know, it's pretty much this. It's not confident enough to be a Gaizu game.
Yeah.
But that's what I was hoping it was. Kind of like, you know, Attack of the Monsters on PS2, which I have also been playing through, which is a lot of fun. It's more like a Dynasty Warriors kind of game. So if you play Dynasty Warriors with the Gundam crossovers or any of those kind of games, it's very similar to that. So it's fun, but like the combat is not very fluid, and it's just kind of like, all right, well, this is €20, so I'm not upset, but if I paid 60, I'd be very upset. However, I did find out that they released another game that is €60. I can't remember the name of it now, but the premise of it is it's like Micro Machines Gundam. So real life Gundam models fight real life things like your cat and stuff.
Oh wow, that sounds awesome.
Yeah, yeah.
It does sound great.
Awesome, but it's not. But it's not. That's the thing. Apparently, it's terrible. And I'm like, oh, that sucks.
Yeah.
But a lot of really weird, like worst of worst of PS4 games list out this year. Like, I didn't get to play a lot of them. And so it seems like that is the premise, right, of a lot of these games, where it's like they had a great idea, but the actual execution of them is so bad. And there's one called, I think it's called Second Life or Second Chance or something like that. I'll find the actual name of it now. But, oh my God, like, the actual premise of it looks fantastic. But apparently what they did is they actually, like, patched out the good part of the game. So broke the game fully. So a patch fixed bits of the game, but crippled the game from being good. So now it's one of the worst games. And you actually get it in GameStop now for $20.
Oh, wow.
It's like, oh, wow, that's not fun. Yeah. But it's kind of like, you know, a deadly premise. It was a similar kind of thing where it was great, but it was a broken mess, and everybody loves how a broken mess. But nowadays we see this where if a game is released and it has some problems, but it still has some charms, actual official patches break the game.
Yep. Well, you kind of saw that as well with the scandal that came over Fallout 76.
Oh my God.
Which is just like
a topic in and of itself.
The scandals and scandals and scandals that have fallen over Fallout 76, from like the constant markdown and pricing to just about everything that can go wrong for a game going wrong. Like, it's gotten to the point where I kind of feel bad for them.
No, you know? I don't feel bad. You know, like, it's the thing about a lot of this stuff was Bethesda's fault, because Bethesda, they know what they're doing. Anytime you play a Bethesda game, you know this is going to be a broken mess. It's going to have massive amounts of bugs, but the storyline's going to be good, and I'm going to have a good time, and the characters and stuff. If they remove out the characters and the writing and the missions and just replace it with broken mess, what do you expect? You know, it's like, this is what's going to happen, guys.
It's not like, look, I'm not surprised and I don't condone it. I feel more sorry for people who've paid full price for it, you know, because
for the people who paid for the special edition.
Yeah.
That's who I feel sorry for.
Which one?
The one, I think the one that takes the, you know, the power
that special bag.
The special bag that's like a nylon bag instead of a, you know.
It was supposed to be like a proper like canvas bag or something, wasn't it? Or
It was supposed to be like a proper canvas kind of military grade bag, but apparently, according to the official press release, they couldn't reach the supplier, so they just had this like crappy nylon bag.
Like, look, that's something that you would expect out of a Kickstarter game.
It's weird. There was no reason for this game to exist. Like, who was this for?
People, do you like Fallout? Do you like playing online? I never really thought there would have been a crossover for that need, you know? Like, did they look at their Elder Scrolls Online numbers and go, yep, there's people out there who will do this for Fallout as well? But
here's the kick on from that. You know, the Elder Scrolls 6, right?
Yeah.
Elder Scrolls 6, so the follow-up to Skyrim now is apparently coming out in summer, which is worrying, because when it was announced, they said we need another 2 years in this.
Yep.
So instead of going, hey, you know what we shouldn't do? We shouldn't rush out things. We should take our time. They're just going to rush stuff too.
Yeah. So, like, that's going to go poorly. Like, I mean, the reality is that, like, Bethesda haven't... I mean, like, Skyrim is probably the last time they actually put out a game on their own that was worth playing. You know, I mean, any other game that you can think of in recent memory, it's come from one of the studios they work with. Like, id Software does Doom. Who does the Dishonored series?
I can't remember.
Yeah, but it's not Bethesda who makes it. Like, they just publish.
Yeah, Bethesda are basically publishers. Yeah.
Yeah, like, I mean, they have their own, like, titles. Like, I mean, their Skyrim and Fallout games are their own, but, like, you know, then every now and again they get they got Obsidian to do New Vegas, and, you know, but it's just, like, I mean, outside of Skyrim, I can't think of a game in recent memory that they made themselves that wasn't a complete buggy mess. And even then, Skyrim was, and it got fixed by the community, you know? Like, it's kind of crazy when you have people who aren't on staff who are fixing your game,
you know. And also but not asking for money. Like,
how long is that going to last, though?
The way they're going, not very long. The reality is that, like you see it time and time again. Anytime that, like, when there's a creative and vibrant community that's taken advantage of, which they absolutely have been, like, they tried to actually do monetized mods, you know. Bethesda's just trying to be a bigger trying to do what the bigger studios do, or bigger publishers do, and it's backfiring hard. And, you know, it's, I mean, like, look, they've been involved in some of my favorite games of all time, but I don't really owe them anything. I paid for my games, you know? Like, it's in the same way.
There is this kind of weird concept now, and it's got to do with microtransactions and stuff like this, where the industry is changing, and until they actually define what a change means in a positive light, we're going to see more of this.
Like, oh, yeah.
If this had went well, Bethesda would have released some games like this all the way through. Sure, look, we live in an industry now where Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 5 was released literally as a demo, and then you pop it in, and you download the game.
Yeah, pretty much.
So, that, because of stuff like that was just set as, oh, well, that's how it is, this is where we are. We're in a situation now where you buy a game, and you instantly have to download the patch.
Yep.
And the patch could be literally the full game, or it could be a way that fixes the game or whatever. Now, Bethesda don't do that. Like, there's been, I watched a video on it, there's like the equivalent of 120 gigs worth of data for Fallout 76.
Yep.
To download. And it's the same. I picked up a game recently, actually. I don't know if you're a big fan of the Saints Row series, but I am. I'm a huge fan of Saints Row series. We'll take a break now at the halfway break, but before we do, I'm a big fan of that series, and I watched a review of Agents of Mayhem, right?
Yep.
Agents of Mayhem was a game that was a broken, horrific mess. Yep. And, you know, didn't really know what it is. However, it's really good. They finally fixed it, but they rushed it out, and by rushing it out, it got a really bad rep. Now, you can actually pick it up in GameStop for €5, by the way, because we're not sponsored by GameStop, we're just saying.
In fact, honestly, we at some point probably will take a segment to trash GameStop, because, like, their pricing is routinely appalling. They routinely have the worst pricing for any games, and they will be talked about at some point. But,
look, credit where credit is due, you know.
Yeah.
You know, they sold it there, and it was legit great. But that game itself, I'm looking forward to playing it. But it took them 2 years. And again, about 120 gigs worth of download space to actually fix the game.
Yep. That doesn't surprise me at all.
It's just like, where's this going to go? You know, like, there's the fabled video game crash. I don't think it's going to be a video game crash again. But
probably will be a video game crash.
But not in the same way as it was in the 80s, where the entire industry was.
Oh, yeah, no. But off. There's crashes, and then there's depressions. Like, it.
Yeah,
like,
I think there'd be a video game depression, not a video game crash.
Yeah, no, but like, as in, like, like, a crash isn't an entire, like, a crash is not the same thing as an entire industry ceasing to exist. Like,
yeah, but that's what the narrative, you know, is online right now, man.
Yeah, but people online don't know what the hell they're talking about when they say stuff like that. Like, the reality is that, like, okay, so 2008, there was a, would you say that was a crash? Because here's the thing, right? So if that's the case, then banking as an industry would no longer exist. So
banking as an industry would no longer exist if it wasn't for a government bailout.
But the thing is that even if bailouts didn't happen, banks would still exist, because that service is still required for people to actually save money.
Banks would always exist.
It's the same thing with gaming here. Like, when the crash does come, because it definitely will, because it's gonna happen within the next 2 years, that loot boxes are gonna be illegal in Europe. 100%.
Well, here's the thing. Loot boxes are illegal.
Oh yeah, they're gonna be they're going to be found
worldwide.
Well, no, they're going to be found to be illegal. It's like they've been found to be illegal in Belgium, and
yeah,
that's where they're. That's where, yeah, and that's where EA are under criminal investigation. Apparently, they're under investigation by so far they're only in under investigation. Loot boxes are only in under investigation in most places for by the gambling commissions, which is basically going, is this mechanic gambling? And at that, and once they return and go, yeah, it's definitely gambling, then criminal investigation will commence. And
all right, okay, well, hold that top in, because we're going to take a quick break, and when we get back, we're going to get into this. This is a very interesting topic, and one I don't want to be watching the ad breaks going through.
Yes.
So guys, keep it here on Phoenix 32.5 FM, Nerd to Know Basis, the first show of 2019. We'll be back after this short break.
You're listening to Phoenix FM, community radio for Dublin 15.
Time for Taboo. Can't believe I have to rap on track, so you get it. Wanna talk about so much stuff, then you just give me hush. We can sort that out for now. The place is packing. Spend big cash on a new dance floor and everyone's coming.
Okay, so you're catching us on the podcast and you want to find out, well, what if I want to listen live and I'm not in Ireland? Well, the TuneIn app has you covered. That's TuneIn. Just look for Phoenix 92.5 FM and you'll be able to check us out live. Don't forget, if you want to contribute to the conversation, go over to Twitter. Nerd2Know 92.5 is our Twitter. That's Nerd2, the number 2. No, 92.5 is our Twitter for the show. If you want to chime in, you can. Every Saturday, 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. here on Phoenix 92.5 FM. Do you like wrestling? Then what are you waiting for? Check out the Wrestling International Desk this Tuesday. And every Tuesday on Phoenix 92.5 FM, 8 p.m. to 9 p.m. with myself, Darragh O'Connor, and my co-host, Bryn O'Rourke, bringing you over 300 editions of the show and counting. The Rescue International, Phoenix 92.5 FM.
Back here, guys, on Phoenix 32.5 FM, Nerd to Know Basis, our first show of 2019. I have to say, Bryn, love the Dreamcast, and I also love the Sonic Adventures soundtrack.
Yeah, you've got that butt rock love, I can tell. Anyway,
oh, man. But look, there's nothing wrong with butt rock.
Yeah,
Puddle and Mud, that album, you know, that one album. Completely,
well, look, I mean, look, man, I'm not judging. I'm just saying that you obviously have a bit of love for Butler Rock. You know,
what's wrong with it? There's nothing wrong with it. It's fantastic.
It's just, I think the critique is that the music isn't very inspired.
Like,
point, like, you know, but it's,
you know,
like,
for example, nothing sums up Butt Rock the worst, like the best and worst parts of it as Puddle of Mud song. What's it called?
She Hates Me.
No. That song's just bad from beginning.
Oh, Blurry.
No. What's the one that was Survivor Series 2001 soundtrack?
The what?
Control. Control. It was the soundtrack for Survivor Series 2001.
Oh God, yeah. Good Lord. Yeah.
Like, that song is so good, except for the bridge. It's like, What? How did this get past producers? It's like, it was, then I remembered who was in charge. It's Interscope, Fred Durst, of course. So
Yeah, but it's like the, like that period of music was just so, like, it's kind of, like, it's cringe, but it's like, I mean, I remember I was recently reading someone, I was recently going through this Reddit thread, and someone was saying that, like, they had, like, a master's in music, and they were talking with one of their professors who they'd gotten to know really, really well through the through their entire program, and he was saying, and they were just like talking about quality music and, you know, how people determine things to be of value and stuff like that. And his professor was going, like, liking something has nothing to do with quality. You know, it's like something you can like something, be fully aware that it sucks, but still like it anyway. It has, like, enjoying something and it being good are not they don't have to correlate with each other. You know,
like, while I get that, I'm still just kind of saying, you know, butt rock, it gets an unfair cut of the jib. You know, I'm like, yeah, it's not great, but it's really fun.
Yeah, but I think, like, you see the a big portion of that is like it's kind of the same way as you know, when you kind of, like, if you throw on your standard assed like action film or whatever, and you get people going, oh, well, there's just nothing intellectually going on. It's like, yeah, but it's a car chase film. Like,
all of the films are like that.
Like, but, like, you know, or like, I recently watched Ready Player One, and, like, I've heard people, because I'm like, for months I've listened to, like, people do reviews about it, and I'm going, like, this film is, like, about pop culture and enjoying yourself, and you can't actually, when you're given the opportunity to do that, and you're saying no, I will not do that. I can only have fun if something is smart. Like, what's the hell? Also, how much of a curmudgeon do you have to be? Like, it's, you know, not everything has to be like such a, like, has to be an intellectually driven experience. Some things can just be enjoyable and not really be all that stirring in any real way. Like, you know, like, I recently read this, I was recently reading Doug Stanhope's book, Digging Up Mother, which is a must read. It's one of the best autobiographies/biographies I've ever read in my entire life. And at one point, he went on this massive diatribe of, like, talking about fart jokes, where he was just like, I love a good fart. I always have. I never want to become such a stickler that I can't actually laugh at a fart. You know, like, he's there going, like, yeah, like, it's like, look, you know, there's, you know, you can read politics and you can be interested in all those things, but if you can't laugh at a fart, then what's the point in living? Like, you know,
no, that's fair.
And you know, that's kind of
Ready Player One. It is what it is.
Yeah.
The book, I like the book, but the author of the book is a distasteful human being.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, so, like, same thing happened with Ender's Game, where the author of that book isn't.
That's unfortunate.
Yeah.
By the way, for anyone who was wondering, the name of that game is called Past Cure.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's what I was looking for. By the way, while we're taking a quick aside here before we finish up in the last 15 minutes, this is show 16, and we actually have an official website for anyone who wants to check it out.
Yeah.
So if you type in nerdtoknowmedia.com, you'll be redirected to our website, which I have to say, I quite like it, Bryn.
Yeah, it's looking quite good. Quite good is what I'm going to go with for the moment.
Quite good. We're still in the state of various stages of development. So there's little Easter eggs hid throughout, basically, you know, walling that off. But you can kind of see where we're going. Links to Twitch, links to some merch from Geeks of the Industry. Geeks of the Industry are linked there as well. There's a link to our media page. Our show archives, there's a cool little contact feature, which will allow you to email us directly. still need to put in some social media links and that, but it's a work in progress. But Nerd to Know Media, as it sounds, as it's spelled, and then you'll be able to, see all the shows there. So if you click into media, it'll take you to our media page. If you click on live, so a live footage function, because some people are asking, how do I listen live? It'll take you right to our stream. So it's all there, guys. Let us know what you think, if you like, if you don't like it, and that's where we're going to be hosted for a while.
So. Yeah, totally. I mean, there's a good few attractions coming in the next while. That we just have to get them ironed out, really, and a couple more features tacked on to our wonderful, wonderful show that just gets better and better.
I think so. You know, like there's a lot coming up this year as well. Speaking of which, we're still, you can kind of see what we're doing if you look close enough. But at the moment, it's still under lock and key. I do want to touch on Bandersnatch real quick. Have you had a chance to see it?
I completely forgot about it until you mentioned it. I'm interested to see it. I've seen some really weird articles pop up around.
They're probably all legit.
I do run with some very interesting folks who try to actually like look for every possible way to see something without having to spend money on it, and they're just like, but how is this even possible with this? I'm like, I'm just going to spend a tenner to get the god to get it. Like, come on, it's not a
we'll put a pin in it because I want to actually break this down with you.
Sure.
In a direct way. But I will say, for anyone who hasn't seen it, after the show's over, after listening to this podcast or whatever, check out Bandersnatch. It's one of the best pieces of media that could turn into a horrible, worrying trend. So I hope it doesn't become a horrible, worrying trend. But for what it is, it's quite good. And like, I made a mistake. I didn't realize it was a choose-your-own-adventure gimmick until I was watching it. And then I'm like, oh, no, it's 4 a.m. So I stayed up to half eight watching it and getting
That's great.
Bad idea.
The only way this, like, I just went like, oh no, are they going to put microtransactions into choices now?
don't worry. When EA get around to it, they will do it.
Yeah.
Also, while we're here as well, I want to talk about a huge rumor. By the way, Into the Spider-Verse, have you seen it yet?
Yeah, I have. It's great. Really, really great.
Told you, great, right? What do you think?
Yeah, really liked it. I knew I would. It's always just nice to see. Like, I kind of like the idea of having like Miles have his own animated run. I think because
I hope that's the last Miles we ever see.
It's really not. Like, it's clear that they're making him into a principal character for the animated movies. You don't like Miles, though.
No.
You're not a fan.
But that's not his fault. I like the Prowler. I think the Prowler's awesome. His costume's pretty cool. Miles needs two things. A good smack and a quick death. And then it'll be fine.
He's not Damian Wayne.
Damian Wayne is cool. Man, Damian Wayne is cool. I like Damian Wayne.
Yeah, but Damian Wayne was also written so the people would go, he needs a good smack and a quick death. Like, which he got,
Jason, that's what Jason Todd was written. Damian Wayne is everything that Miles Morales isn't.
Yeah, but Miles is also not trying to be Damian Wayne, so that's fine. Like,
I don't know, man. I don't know. Look,
like, Miles is trying to be a nice kid. Like, I don't understand. You're basically going, damn you, Miles. You're so non-threatening. Like, it's like Spider-Man is supposed to be a threatening guy. Like, I don't understand. Like, your criticism here is a bit he's a Spider-Man character. Jesus, lighten up. Like,
he was doing all that singing, though, in the movie. And I'm like, man, you look like such a...
So
you know,
like,
that's a thing that people do. Like, it's
no, man. It just me out. I'm like, come on, have some, you know, be like Prowler, be like your uncle. He's cool. Come on, be cool like him. You know,
I really enjoyed the story overall. Like,
me too.
I really do like the whole arc with him and his dad kind of coming together at the end. I thought that was really well done. The Peter B. Parker's arc, realizing that he wants to be a dad, was so well executed. Overall, really, really liked it. Really annoyed that the cinemas didn't ushered me out before we could get to the post-credits trailer, which is a bit annoying.
You know what it was, though?
From hints that you'd given me, I'm assuming that that my boy Miguel O'Hara shows up.
Hold on, spoilers. We're going to play the spoilers whistle. I'll put one in post. Basically Miguel O'Hara, he goes back in time and goes to the original 1960s Spider-Man cartoon.
Oh, cool. Sweet.
And then they do the meme.
Oh, class. That's really cool. Yeah. Great. Great stuff.
Yeah, it's quite good. So, guys, definitely a DVD buy.
Yeah.
I know. Look,
or even I want to download buy.
Oh yeah. Either way, you know, it's definitely support.
2019. Come on, it's a digital download.
Look, buy. DVDs aren't bad. Okay, there's nothing wrong with physical media.
Yeah, well, you know, it's still like
cassette tapes in 2019. I got two orders last night. I can't believe it.
Also, the format is a Blu-ray, I believe. Which weirdly have more memory and less features on them than normal DVDs had in the mid-2000s. You know, but
we made a mistake, people. We made a mistake.
Yeah, right. I want my commentaries back.
I want my commentaries back.
Seriously, DVD commentaries were one of my favorite things in the world.
I never once watched one. I'm not going to lie to you.
Because they're basically podcasts attached to films. That's basically what they are.
I'm watching films, I'm doing like four different things at the same time, so having a time to listen to it.
No, but you see, like, the thing was, like, I would just obsessively, like, watch films, and then I get to a point of going, well, I wonder what the director has to say. And on most occasions, that would pay off to some degree, except for the one time I sat down to watch Star Wars Episode 2, and all it is George Lucas and me, and I'm sitting there for 2 hours as George Lucas drones on about details I cannot possibly care less about.
Yeah, you see, you know what I used to do?
Yep.
They're the only director commentary I listen to where the Star Wars prequels.
Yeah, they're awful. They're really awful. Yeah. They're really awful. The best ones for entertainment value, for unrivaled entertainment value, and this goes for everyone. You have to find the Anchorman on DVD just to listen to the DVD commentary on it. Because as funny as the film is, the commentary is kind of amazing. Because one thing they do that happens in no other commentary I've ever listened to is that people come in and out of the commentary booth. So like people on commentary, and they have people on like a speakerphone and everything as well. So, like, they had, like, Will Ferrell and the director doing it for the whole way through. Paul Rudd comes in on speakerphone at one point. Kyle Gass, of all people, just walks into the commentary booth. It's kind of cool. Like, it's fun.
I did Anchorman 2 before I actually watched this, listen to the commentary.
The first Anchorman movie. The second, I haven't seen, like, the second film I watched once and went, this is terrible, and never watched anything about it again. I've also got a soft spot for the actor's comment because in the special editions for the Lord of the Rings films, like the extended editions that they had, you get like a choice between like a few different commentaries. One of them is where it's all the like a bunch of the actors together talking, and that's class because they just basically just talk crap throughout each part, like through all 4 hours of like each film, each extended film. And it's a really fun, it's just really fun to listen to them. Those would be two of the better ones I've heard. But man, George Lucas. So like, I thought that he was a pretty dull guy. Now I know for a certainty, he is a really dull guy. Like
visionary though. Wheeling back.
Well, you see, the thing is that the more I learn, the more I learn about the original production, the less I'm like, I'm not sure if it's him that was the visionary or if it was his wife.
Her wife, just get Disney away from whatever they're doing. Get Kathleen Kennedy away from Star Wars. But anyway, that's something we'll talk about next week, I think. But listen, what's coming up in this year, right? Already, the hype is beginning for Dublin City Comic Con Spring Edition. So that's happening in March. So March the 9th, 10th, 2019.
ECC, Spring Harder.
The what?
ECC, Spring Harder.
Spring Harder. But man, like, the guests are starting to come in, and you know, the Green Ranger himself is going to be there.
Yeah.
So I can't wait to go and cry and just, you know, so it's like, you know, it's gonna be bad. So I'm looking forward to that. James Marsden is there,
sweet.
The guy who played Spike, and he's an angel as well. Jonathan Frinks from Star Trek.
Nice. Brilliant. There.
Douglas Jones, pretty much the weird face. He's like any weird monster movie that you've seen, he's been in. So he's in Hellboy, The Shape of Water, Fantastic Four. He played the Surfer.
Yeah.
He was in Buffy. And they did recently announce that Michael Goodis and Pom Kefi have both been, Michael's been cancelled and Pom has been scheduled to August.
That's so cool.
So, yeah, so it's going to be fun. So obviously we're going to try to get one of the guys in, or Olivia from DCC in the next few months before
that. Definitely has to happen.
I'm looking forward to that. It's going to be great.
I can't wait to ask you, James Marsh, as well, as he thinking about doing Dragon Ball Evolution. That's going to be fun.
Yeah, well, we'll see. Our last year was our first real kind of run at covering a convention, so now we know what to do and what not to do.
I genuinely hope someone asks him at his panel, what were you thinking when you signed on to do Dragon Ball Evolution? Also, what was he thinking of doing when he wanted to sign on to Smallville?
I think it'll be similar to when someone asked John Romero about Daikatana.
Yeah, hopefully. If only all panelists could be as interesting as John Romero.
That's true. Actually, there's a really good series I'm watching usually now called What Happened? It's actually called What Happened, but that's what it's called. And it goes through like the history of game development.
Yeah.
And those are really like infamous game development. So one of them was on Daikatana, which means big sword in Japanese, which is fast. But then there's one on like Ride to Hell, Retribution, on Splatterhouse, and loads of others. So I think you'll really appreciate that, Brent.
Yeah, I'll have to check that out.
Right, guys. So we have quickly run out of time. Oh my god, this show just flies. It's too short.
We need 2 hours.
Phoenix FM, 2 hours, damn it.
Right. So before we go, Bryn, is there anything you want to plug?
I'll plug my favorite YouTube show of recent that's Misinformed. So you can find that on YouTube. It's youtube.com/misinformed. Basically the premise for every episode is that you will be told nothing that is factually correct and usually factually hilarious. And it's so well presented. I don't know the name of the person who does the show, but he has such a dry presentation to how he presents the information that he has, that it's usually really funny. I highly, highly recommend checking out Misinformed. And very quickly, go to geeksintheindustry.com to check out our good friends over there with all their numerous podcasts with all their amazing, amazing names.
And remember, if you want to find a link directly, you can just go over to nerdtoknow.com and the link is there if you just click on
Yes.
Follow us on Twitter at nerd2, the number 2 media, nerdtoknow, the number 2 media on Twitter. And we'll be back next week, hopefully without all the technical issues. So until then, I've been Darrell Connor. He's been Bruno Rourke.
Bye.
You're listening to Phoenix FM, community radio for Dublin 15.